Okay, it is my pleasure to introduce Patrick McDaniel from Penn State. He is a distinguished professor. He is a fellow of the ACM, a fellow of IEEE, and leads some big Army research laboratory program. $60 million, he said?
$50 million.
Okay, so he's...
But who's counting?
He's a big guy. So, and... you know, if you work in the area, you'll see he's written lots of papers on Android security and related stuff, which is one of the reasons why we invited him today. And he's going to tell us about the arc of smartphone application security today.
Great, thanks. First, I'd like to say thanks to your new dean, Marios, which you stole from my alma mater, Michigan. And Alex, your chair, and Michael, we've known each other 9 on 20 years. I've been working in the same area of security. Really an honor to be here and be one of the distinguished, give a distinguished lecture here at the UCI. But what I want to do today is I want to talk a little about history. I want to talk about how security in one limited domain evolved. And I'm going to talk, you know, completely narcissistically. I'll talk about my research as it relates to that. But really what I want to talk about is how our understanding of smartphone security and really what smartphones are with respect to our privacy and our behaviors, how that evolved over time. And I think the best way to talk about any technology is when it goes bad. So put yourself in summer of 2010, an application shows up on the Google Play market. And some security researchers at a black hat presentation say, oh, here's this application that's now on the Android market. It's grabbing some personal information, some phone identifiers, and sending them to an Asian country. This is a terrible, terrible thing. And then the internet does what the internet does best, freaking out, right? So what happened is that there were many articles, and as the internet became the internet, or does what the internet does, that collection of information began to grow. And as it transferred from the internet to the popular press, it became the story that this particular application was grabbing your browsing habits and your emails and your SMS traffic and sending them to foreign agents. Turns out that most of that wasn't true. Some of it was. What was originally discovered in the black hat actually was true. Actually, some of that information was being captured and was being sent to an Asian country. And Google did an investigation and they found out, you know, basically what happened was the developer was trying to create profiles of people to track this particular kind of application, and he essentially just chose really sensitive information to create a pseudo identity. And so there wasn't any real evidence that there was something malicious going on here. But that's not really what I think is interesting about this story. What is interesting about this story is what kind of application it was. It's actually shown here. This is a circa 2010 Android device. Anybody guess what this application, anybody remember what this application was? It was a desktop application. It would swap pictures that were on your phone every so often. It would be a kitten 1 minute, and then it'd be a mountain range the next. Okay. Now, the real question for me when this happened, this is a moment of clarity, as we say, in security, and I said, what in the hell is this application doing with the rights to access phone identifiers? All it's doing is swapping desktop pictures. There's something going on here. Something going on here in this new environment, this mobile device environment, where we're seeing privileges being given to applications, and those applications and the users that use them are accepting this new state of security. And something fundamentally has changed in security at this moment. We see this in the dawning of the 2010 era. We see that the nature of security within these mobile environments was changing. We were used to sort of traditional thinking of traditional operating system security, and something had actually changed. But that's not really the broader context. The broader context was much more interesting. So I think just within the last week or so, it might even be today, I can't remember, We're on the 10th anniversary of the introduction of the iPhone. Okay? And this was, and we'll look back at this 100 years from now as a technology inflection point. Something happened when we introduced smartphones. It's not a hyperbole to say the nature of existence on this planet changed with the introduction of these devices. So rolling it back a little bit further. So let's go back into the middle 1990s, late 1990s. There was a huge community that was studying something called ubiquitous computing. We saw it coming. We knew that computation was going to be surrounding us, and we knew it was going to augment our daily lives. And we had all sorts of highfalutin ideas on what this new mobile computing, ubiquitous computing, was going to do. Our rooms were going to talk to us, and they were going to do predictive data caching and all sorts of great things to make our lives better. But what we didn't anticipate in the late 1990s was the killer apps wasn't smart rooms, it was Uber. It was Flappy Bird. Those were the kinds of applications which were going to be the technology drivers that would change the nature of computation on this planet. So what is it about these devices? The irony being I'm talking about Android all day with an Apple device in my hand. What is it about those devices that's different, right? From our traditional notion of computation, right? The traditional notion of computation is you've got a beige box with a CRT on top and a keyboard, and if you're really advanced, you'll have a mouse, okay? You're gonna sit there and it'll be connected to some kind of network, okay? The nature of the relationship between you and that computation is very fixed, it's very static. You sit down, more likely than not, you log into that computer, you have a system which has something we refer to as a system security policy. That's essentially the guarantees that an operating system is providing. It's the governance it makes over programs that run on that computer. You go through your session, you interact with that session, and then you log out and your day is done. Okay? That's a very traditional notion, but when you move into this new world, in this mobile device world, that changes tremendously. Now, these devices are part of our presence, our physical presence. They go everywhere we go. They're sort of seamlessly moving between networks and infrastructure. No longer is our connection to a Cat5 cable on the back of our box, do we know where it's going? Often we will connect on and off. We'll drive down. I don't know how many people have experienced this. You'll be driving by a Starbucks and all of a sudden your mobile device will go from, all of a sudden you'll jump onto that Starbucks network for a minute. That did so without me actually knowing. It's very malleable. You're moving between different environments. Other parts of computation had less to do with the mobility, but had to do with the capabilities of the evolving network technology. For example, most of the data on this phone, if I lost this phone, if I just went out onto that balcony, hucked it into traffic and smashed into a million pieces, the amount of data that I would actually lose is very small. And that's because most of the data on this device is replicated on the cloud, it's replicated to my desktop, it's replicated to my iPad, to my watch. It's replicated all over the place. And so my data is actually moving. Okay. One of the other things that's really changed, and this is perhaps where it starts to impact ourselves as a society, is that now these devices are social instruments, right? This isn't about spreadsheets and documents and getting homework done anymore. This is about how we communicate. Those of you who spend time on college campuses, if you walk across campus, in between any set of classes, you will see about half of the students, and they'll be looking into their phone devices, and you'll say, oh, wow, isn't that sad? They're sort of in their own isolated world. No, their world is actually connected to 500 other people that are sitting looking at screens at other parts of campuses and around the world. The social instrument is what these devices become, how we communicate, and it's augmented our world. Our world has actually gotten a lot bigger. I mean, how many of you, particularly those of us who are a little bit older generation, have reconnected with people in high school we hadn't talked to in 15 years, right? That's part of the socialist movement. Our world is actually getting better through these devices. And then when you start looking into sort of the enterprise space and you start seeing the mobility as actually changing the nature of how we carry out our jobs, right? So if my students are driving me crazy, or I know some students got a problem and I want to go hide, I go find the nearest Starbucks, I grab my laptop. That mobility allows me to do that. So what does this mean? Right, so this is all true and it's probably cliche, but it also changes risk, right? And the risk we're facing changes. the way we have to secure our data, the kinds of attacks, the kinds of privacy invasions we're going to experience have changed with that change in the way we deal with computation. And the very kinds of things we're doing with these devices also changes risk. For example, we were at Panera. Michael and I were at Panera today, and he purchased the coffee and donuts we had for our meeting with his watch. Okay, I've never seen anybody do that before. That kind of interaction. Now these devices aren't simply for sort of traditional computation, but they're also for economic as well as social. So what does all this mean? Well, what it means is that the nature of how we need to interpret security concerns changes. And there's another side of this, and this is perhaps as computer scientists, as engineers, here is how our discipline, or certainly the practice, the professional practice of our discipline has changed. So prior to what we refer to as software markets, mid-late 90s, you would go to a bricks and mortar store, if you can believe it, called Borders, and you would buy a box, and that would have your software. And depending on how old you were, you'd be sticking 5 1/4, or 3 1/2, or CDs, and you would go and you would install your software that way. And you had a physical connection to the people selling you software. Borders had a contract with Microsoft as a reseller. If you wanted Microsoft Office, they had a contract. You would go to Borders and you would pay Borders for the right to buy Microsoft Office at that time. The nature of the software relationship was very clear. You had bricks and mortar stores that you went to, and they had professional contractual interactions with the software providers. Now, with the introduction of markets, and to a lesser degree, the introduction of the internet, the nature of software distribution and the software industry completely changed. And where it really explodes really is right at the introduction of what we refer to as mobile markets. Mobile markets exist to provide people software. Google Play, the Amazon Store, there are lots of other markets, the Apple Store, all of these things provide a conduit to you, right? That you pay some nominal fee, like $99 to Apple. I forget what how much it costs to get a Google license. You become a developer, you write code, then you go back to Apple or Google, and then they do some sort of vetting, and we'll get into that in a couple minutes. They'll do some sort of vetting, and then they will give you the software. They will then put that on the market, which people can then buy, right? So the market incentives here are strong. Whatever Apple or Google can do to reduce that distance between the developer and the user is really important. We're going to talk a lot about economics today. The economic distance, or the what we refer to as the market barrier to providing software to people, is approaching zero. Okay? So the relationship between you and the people writing your software, on one hand, has never been closer. It's never been easier to put your software in people's hands. However, paradoxically, it's never been harder to know where your software comes from. And this is going to introduce a tremendous number of economic realities we're going to talk about today. Okay? And we refer to this as a market environment or a market economy. And we're going to see that has a lot of challenges. So, rewinding, late 2007, iPhone comes out. We're going to come up to Android in a couple minutes, 2008. We did not know what this meant. And we'll talk why the security structures are the way they are in mobile systems for the rest of the day. But at the time, there was this new way of defining security in mobile systems. We didn't know what that really meant and what the implications were. We didn't even have tools to figure out what vulnerabilities, if any, existed within those individual systems. And so what I'm going to talk about today is the first epoch. Essentially the first 4 years or so of security research in Android, where we as a community, in the security community, asked some very, very pressing questions about, okay, so now we're defining our security in a new and interesting way. What exactly does that mean? Now we've moved to what we refer to as a rights-based security system. What are applications asking for? And what are the implications to our security? And then what do they do with those rights? And then ultimately, the most important question, what can they do with those rights? For those of you taking pictures, I'm going to make these slides publicly available. So I have been working in this space, as Michael mentioned, for really since the inception of mobile markets. And so I've continued a long string, and I really want to focus there. I sort of view, and I'm going to really talk about the first epoch, but there's really two epochs to our understanding of mobile systems. And I really want to focus on the first, because I think it sort of tells a story of how we as a security community took a look at a new and important technology and unwound it. I find myself in a tremendously advantageous position that I got to be at the beginning of a technology and watch security and our understanding of it and the countermeasures and the structures we use to protect it evolve over the last decade. And so I really want to tell you again, as I mentioned at the outset, a history. So before I get into the history, let's get a little technical detail here. A lot of this is pretty straightforward. Android. Does anybody have an Android device? Can I have it?
Oh,
I'm a security guy. I can't believe that worked. Okay, so my new phone is actually embedded Linux. Okay, so this is actually a Linux system, very much like the systems you've used before. And really what it is what Android is not an operating system the way people think of traditional operating systems, but it's actually a middleware layer. And in that middleware layer, you have lots of applications which you've downloaded, right? And those applications, I'm not going to ask you what they are. Those applications, when they're run in their own virtual machines. This is just basic Java. You write these programs in Java. Do you guys actually teach any Android programming here? No. Some? Anybody ever programmed in Android? Yeah. Okay, the smattering. Okay, so basically all Android is a bunch of API calls and a bunch of structures for writing programs. They run on specialized virtual machines. Originally they were called the Dalvik virtual machines. They're now called ART, or the Android Runtime System. For the purposes of this talk, there's no difference between Dalvik and ART. ART is really just an improved version of the Dalvik runtime environment in which it was optimizing things like loading and just-in-time compilation. So each one of these applications that we download and we run, they're isolated in a virtual machine, they're sandboxed away from each other, and the way that Android governs how these applications interact is through permissions. Okay, so permissions are things, are basically rights that are given to an application. Now, when you download an application, how many people have seen the little screen that says, do you allow it to do X, Y, and Z? Right, and you say, well, what do you say?
Yes.
Of course, anybody ever said no? No, of course not. We can get into why Google wants, what's the phrase I'm looking for? Plausible deniability. You said it, it's not my fault, you said yes. So they all run, you're given permissions, and those permissions allow you access to other interfaces. Sometimes they're system interfaces that are like things like the GPS receiver or the camera. Sometimes there are other applications. For example, you have a permission to use the mapping function. So if your application is given a mapping function, it creates an IPC, an inter-process communication, basically called an intent, which said sends a message to the application which implements maps, and it says, here's a coordinate, pull this up in your map. In order to do that, your application has to be given the right to use the mapping interface. Okay? That's how we define security in Android. What you're doing is you're assigning rights to the physical hardware, the Android interfaces, as well as interfaces provided by other applications. Now you gotta ask the question, why is it designed this way? So if you put yourself back in basically 2008, what was happening inside the economy is iPhone, when it hit the market, those of us who remember, it went crazy. Everyone bought an iPhone. Because suddenly you had the kind of computational promise that people had been waiting for a decade and a half. All of a sudden you could use that. iPhone took off. And I remember being actually at a security conference when we did the first Android work, and they said, why are you wasting your time on Android? Apple's gonna own it, right? It was not clear that, and there was like BlackBerry and several other operating systems out there. It wasn't clear Android was going anywhere. So what did Google do? Well, they designed it to make the programming as simple as possible. Why do you use Java? Well, in 2007, what was the very first class you were? What's the first programming language you were taught? Java. Everyone knew how to use Java. Why would you move to a simple permission model, which doesn't provide a lot of what we refer to as context to make security decisions? Because it reduces the barrier to market. Okay, so they built this infrastructure so that you could write the applications really, really easily. Okay, application markets at the same time were taking off. And I actually have a column, if you're interested, it's an IEEE Security Privacy magazine I wrote a couple years ago, on there's a misunderstanding, I think, by the user community, and I don't really have time to get into it too much, that markets provide security. And they don't, right? Importantly, the thing to know, I gave your phone back, right?
Yep.
Oh, good. the important thing to know about application markets is that they can't provide security. Security is an entirely contextual thing. What I consider secure may be very different from what you can consider. The kinds of things that I am worried about may be very different than the kinds of things you're worried about. So a market can make some best effort, like that doesn't exhibit, you know, overt malicious behavior, it doesn't include overt malware, but that's not the same thing as saying that it's actually secure. Okay? So applications don't provide markets, so something else must. And that is, and if you remember nothing else from this talk, the important thing to know about mobile markets right now is that the security that you get out of these devices is the composite of the decisions you as users make. And it hasn't changed since the inception of these mobile devices. And therein lies the peril, because we, for the vast majority of us, don't have enough information to know whether or not that composite of decisions represents a good and secure state of my phone. So just to take a little bit step in a more technology standpoint, you can think of Android as providing a very simple kinds of classical mandatory access control. Basically, things are given a set of rights, and the operating system enforces those rights within a sort of fixed set of constraints. So importantly, we're going to talk a little about permissions. Good permissions are location, that's GPS. There's two kinds of GPS, fine and coarse, you know, meter versus 10 meters. Phone IDs, which are things like IMSIs and TIMSIs and things like that, which are basically cellular identifiers. Microphone, camera, address book, SMS, and then of course the application interfaces themselves. Okay. So the important thing to know is now we've got this classical mandatory access control system. Well, what can we do to actually evaluate it? Now, it's interesting to know at Marshmallow a couple years ago, they modified the permission model so that you can have partial acceptance of rights and you can do runtime revocation, which for those of us in the security realm, when that happened, we sort of pulled whatever hair I had left out of my head. Because once you start having runtime modifications to rights, it makes things like classical proving things like safety for applications basically impossible. But we're really just not really going to focus too much at that level. We're going to talk about how the market actually evolved. Okay. September 23rd, 2008. Android 1.0 hits the market. Okay, so now it's a latecomer. There's several other competing platforms out there. And it hits the market with a little bit of fanfare, but not as much as you would expect from an organization like Google. So, that fall, using some contacts I had with Google and one of my students, a guy named Will Enk, who's on the faculty at NC State, we dove into the Android system, and we said, okay, this is undiscovered country for us. What is the very first question we want to ask? Right, and we now are moving to a new definition of security, which is definition of security is that as you install applications, your system policy changes, and the system policy really just says whatever the application says is okay. What can we do from a security standpoint in order to evaluate whether applications were doing things that were potentially dangerous. So we actually took a step back and said, okay, well, the very first thing we want to do is we want to look for collections of permissions and behaviors from phone, from applications at the inception of the market, and ask yourself, well, does that represent any kind of dangerous activity? And again, we had the original source code to the first version of Android. And so we modified the installer. We rewrote the installer. And what it would do is it would take a system policy, which are a set of permission sets that we deemed dangerous, and said, no, you can't install those. Okay? And it's not really the installer that was really all that interesting. And in fact, this was 2000, CCS 2009, nominally the number for the first paper ever to appear in smartphone security. But basically, we said, okay, we don't have a system policy. You're assembling, by asserting permissions, you're getting this kind of aggregate behavior. What are things that we can do and look at permission sets that don't look right? So another one of my students, a woman named Mashgar Antong, who is now a professor in Thailand, she and I sat down for about 4 months and went through a pretty lengthy process, which is called security requirements engineering, which comes out of the software engineering community. And we established a set of rules that said, here are things that are manifestly dangerous behaviors. So let me give you an example. So what boot complete is, this is actually a received intent for an application. It basically says, when the phone starts, I should start the application. And we saw the permissions associated with an application. It says, if we have permissions, find location, that's GPS, has access to the internet, can use the network, and gets started when the phone boots up, that represents something that is dangerous. Why? What is this a signature of? GPS coordinates, use of the network, and is always running. It's tracking. It's just a tracking app. That is just a straight up, that is the ability. Now, that doesn't mean an application that asks for these rights actually is a tracker. But what it says is it has the rights to be a tracker, right? So what we did is we actually started off and we broke the Android market for the first time. Basically, this is January of 2009. If you're counting at home, basically the Android market is about 3 months old. This is the early version of the Google Play. And then of the 16 categories that exist at that time, we downloaded the top 20 applications, and we tested the permissions. Now, you'll note there's only 311 applications. I'll tell you how early in the market this was. Some of the categories didn't even have 20 applications in it yet. Okay, so this is 3 months in, and we used these 9 permission sets, and we said, okay, are any of the applications, essentially at the onset of the Google Play market, were any of the applications actually manifestly requesting rights that should not have been granted to the phone because they're dangerous? Well, we basically, of those 311 applications, we had 5 that had 5 dangerous configurations. But if you actually looked at what the applications did, then it sort of made sense. But we found 5 that had real dangerous functionality that should not have been allowed. And the ones that we were, well, 3 of the applications we found that were really dangerous, that actually we had Google put some, well, I'll get into that in a minute. So basically they had phone state record, record audio, and internet permissions. That's basically know when somebody's called, be able to record audio, and use the internet. That's called an eavesdropping application. Basically, anytime the phone rings, if you have this set of permissions, you can refork the data back to some other place. Some of these things could make sense. Things like Shazam, that's really what it did. It was actually recording. The last one, we could never really get a straight answer out of the developers on why inauguration report would have this functionality. But that really wasn't what was really interesting about the first study. So the first study, we not only did we look at the application permissions, but we actually did a permission analysis throughout the entire Android system. Actually, we had a source code, and we were looking at whether the Android platform itself violated any of these actual rules. And it turns out we actually found some pretty serious stuff. We found out that in the version of 1.0 of Android, that they had not put permissions on the ability to launch broadcast intents, which are basically ways of sending out information to all the applications, in this case, SMS. So basically, because the early Google Android 1.0 didn't protect the ability to generate to broadcast that a new text message had arrived, any application had the ability to forge incoming SMS traffic. And if you realize that there are a lot of banking applications, certainly of that era, that were using SMS to send things like tokens, this was a really, really dangerous prospect. And in fact, this was there was five or six of these broadcast permissions that actually, after working with Google, when they revved almost immediately 1.1, they actually put permissions on all of those things. But the nice thing we were able to do is we were looking at some of the Anderson properties. You know, if you think about reference monitor properties of complete mediation, we were able to evaluate the Anderson, the complete mediation of the Android in that early market. So now, that's 2009, we move into 2010. Will Inc. goes off to Intel for the summer. Before he leaves, we start looking at taint tracking in the Android system, working with Jaeyeon Jung, who is now, she just left for South Korea just recently, over the summer, and myself, we started developing a system called TaintDroid. So, what is taint tracking? Well, taint tracking is basically where you take a system and you track information flow by marking the use of a variable or the as it flows through a program. For example, if you add two numbers together, then the result gets put in a new variable. That new variable has the union of the taint marks of the two variables. So what are you doing here? What you're doing is you're just basically providing a supervisor mode which tracks through execution information flow. So what we did, and so people have some misunderstanding about taint. Droid is not an application, it is a rewrite of the entire Android firmware. So we modified the IPC layer, the virtual machines, the native system libraries, the network interface, even the secondary storage. And what we're able to do is create taint tracking from individual lines of programs all the way through the phone, all the way through the system as it went into secondary storage and came back out of secondary storage, so that you could track when some particular data was being accessed within the phone, and then you could find where it was being exfiltrated, for example, over the network later. Okay, and that's the promise of TaintDroid. Now, I don't really have too much time to get into the details, but we did a lot of optimization, so we could actually run this thing, TaintDroid, with something, I want to say it's about 15% overhead. So basically, for you using the phone when you're running TaintDroid under that firmware version, you really wouldn't even notice that it was actually running. But again, the technology itself is kind of cool. But I think the impact is really where this was felt. So what did we do? So basically, this is 2010. Now, I have to remember, in 2010, the markets and the economy surrounding mobile systems was still nascent. We didn't really understand where money was flowing. And while you were getting applications in 2010, you were downloading them on their phone and they were free, it wasn't very clear what the economic model supporting their development was. And so this was a really interesting question, exactly what's going on with this economy. So we did a study. So we randomly selected 30 applications from the top 1,200 applications in the Google market at that time, more or less at random. We selected applications that had some internet and then some sensitive data like GPS coordinates, microphone, and camera information. And then we ran this taint tracker. And again, what this does is when you access the GPS in your application, it will know when that application exfiltrates that data either through secondary storage or something else. So we ran all these applications and we found 105 connections from running these 30 applications. Basically, you know, this is dynamic analysis as much as we could. We went through all the interfaces. We used all the functionality that was available. We found 105 connections. 37 of them were clearly legitimate. They were actually legitimate uses of the sensitive data, but the rest were not. And this is where it gets interesting. So 2010. So if you remember, in the middle of 2010, this was actually a paper in OSDI. There was an enormous outrage. So basically, of the 30 applications, half of them at that time were taking GPS coordinates and shipping them across the network to third-party providers, essentially ad networks. Okay, I remember I was talking to a guy, John Schwartz at the New York Times, the night before this the paper was actually presented, and there was huge press exposure afterwards. And I think this was the first real insight we as a community had into the underlying economics. We actually sort of exposed in this story that indeed, when you're getting these free downloaded applications, you're paying with something. You're paying with your identity, with your privacy, that's kind of a strong word. You're paying with some profile information about you, depending on the applications. And that's the economic trade-off. Now, the cost to you is a little bit amorphous, right? It's really hard to get your arms around what that cost is to you, and that's what makes the economic model so attractive. But as it turns out, there's a billion-dollar industry, multi-billion-dollar industry, in developing profiles of you and what you do to understand how to market to you. Those profiles are enormously valuable. Okay, and so what we found in 2010 is those applications were taking GPS coordinates, something about you personally, about your physical location, and sending them out. Now, it turns out that a lot of these applications weren't actually exposing this behavior. I'm afraid I'm going to misspeak, but I think it's something like two or three of them actually had an oblique mention of the use of your GPS information. Most of them didn't. Now, this is actually a packet capture of data that was coming from one of these applications. So as it turns out, they're not even trying hard to hide it at this point, right? No one knows that they're actually doing this. Now, there's been a particularly interesting moment in the politics of industry. So you have to remember, this is 2010. Google has just bought AdMob for X gazillion dollars. And we get into a fairly public fistfight with Google about, you know, whether this half of these applications is somehow representative of their market. Now, I'm not suggesting that Google had any sinister motives, but they suggested that this random sampling was simply not enough to inform the economy. Well, there's some truth to that. However, it quickly became a story that said the study was flawed, and ended up being sort of for a brief couple of years, there was a really kind of tension between the security community and Google on specifically the depth and breadth of the use of personal information by these applications. Now, it's long since gone by the wayside, but it's important to understand that in sort of an industrial context. Now, some other things that were actually going on at the same time. In these applications, we were seeing something that everybody thought was sacrosanct. We thought that you were not supposed to use your cellular identifiers in these applications. There was supposed to be a clean separation between the use of these phone identifiers because they essentially identify your hardware, and by proxy, they identify you. Okay? It turns out of these 15 applications, 7 of them actually were using things like IMEIs, and 2 of the applications were using even things like phone numbers. I'm going to get back to this in a little while. But the important thing is almost a third of these applications as of 2010 were already looking for other ways to extract identity-based information from you in ways that were sort of opaque. Not sort of, that were opaque to the people that were downloading those applications. And this creates a tension between the privacy community and the technical community and industry. And I think there's a bit of a detente as it exists today, but there are no clear practices. But what's important here is that we're beginning to highlight that we as a security community have a public policy duty to inform these kinds of discussions, to expose these behaviors. There's a lot of discussion around exactly, well, when do you want to say that, for example, an application is sharing that information? Now, certainly we talk to Google frequently, and I have a great relationship with them today. I think, you know, sunlight is great disinfectant. I think the more we can say about these applications and their behaviors, the better we are, the better off we are. There are some needs for regulatory structures for mandating the disclosure of information, but that's a whole another hour-long rant, perhaps for another day. All right, so now let's take a step back. It's 2010, right? So 2010, suddenly there's an outcry, but it's still not really clear what's going on in these mobile markets. So we understand, okay, so there's a hidden economy here, as John Schwartz put it, a hidden economy going here. But what does it really look like? So we took a step back. And in order to go to talk about the next piece, I have to do a little bit of a technical sidestep. So When your Android applications are compiled, they're compiled into Java classes, right? And those Java classes are then run through something called the Dalvik compiler and turned into a new bytecode format called Dalvik. And in so doing, you're moving from one target architecture, the Java instruction set, which has an enormous amount of debugging information, into one that has much less. For example, the big difference between something like Java, a virtual machine, and the Dex is you're moving from a stack-based, from register to stack. Your constant pools for all of your classes get smooshed into one. Your type lattice goes out the window. There's a lot of types that actually get smunged up. For example, things like null references and zeros are the same thing in the Dalvik bytecode. And so what you get is all of the code smashed together, all of the constant pool, which is all your constants and static data and things like that, all smashed together. And you get this really packed in version with smaller instructions, a smaller instruction code size, and packed down. And of course, that makes a ton of sense, right? Because you're talking about a mobile device, right? You really want to have a compact version. Unfortunately, that transformation from the Dalvik format to from Java to the Dalvik format, you lose an enormous amount of information. Like your typing system goes out the window. Now arguable to say that there is no language that has had more programming language analysis tools developed for it than Java. And so we looked at this problem and said, if we try to reconstruct all of these program analysis tools for this new code set, we've lost all of this information, we're going to reinvent PL, and it's going to take us a quarter of a century, right? So what we really needed, and this is actually, there's an interesting point of fact, this is where me and Dave Wagner is a guy at Berkeley, he went in one direction. He actually started to try to do that. He tried to start building the tools, and he had a really, and I'll talk about one of his tools in a couple minutes. But I said, no. What we want to do is we want to reverse this transformation. And this started a process that took about 4 years. I have a student named Damien Akito, who just happens to be sitting at the point man of the Google Play Store today, who helped me build, or worked with me, and did most of the heavy lifting on developing a set of decompilers. The first one was called DED, and basically that was sort of an ad hoc version of a decompiler, where we basically reconstructed and retargeted back from the bytecode. And these are available if you need to get your source code. We retargeted it back to Java classes. We were able to take applications and return them into a Java class files so that we can start using static analysis tools. That was actually 2011, 2012. The more interesting one, which is Foundations of Software Engineering Best Artifact, 2012, I think it was. Basically, we formalized this reverse transformation and created an intermediate language that allows us to take close to 300 opcodes in the Dalvik code system, reduce it into seven rules, and able to by generating some constraints, doing a lot of PL gains, we were able to retarget, and we were able to up the accuracy of our retargeting progress to basically 100%. But that's really what is interesting. It's a very cool tool, and it's something that people have been studying since. But I think it actually led to the one point where I think we as a community learned more than at any given point in the history of mobile systems. And this was William Enke, again, my student who's now at NC State. This was sort of his magnus opus of his dissertation. He and I took a look in 2011, and we had the original the DED source code retargeting decompiler. I hadn't finished the DARE yet. And we said, okay, we now have something that decompiles programs, and no one knows we have it. So what are we going to do? We want to look and see what kind of dangerous functionality we have. So I remember the day I sat down with my students in my conference room, and I said, we got one shot at this. No one knows we can decompile back to source. And certainly the people developing these applications. So at no point in history will they not know we're coming, except this one time. What are we going to do? So we spent about 6 months going through and created 52 different security analysis, static analysis tools that I'll talk about in a minute. But at the same time, we broke the market for the third time and were able to extract the top 1,100 applications out of the Android, 50 per of the 22 application categories of the day. And we were able to grab all of these applications, decompile them, and ended up with 21 million lines of code in 2011, which is a snapshot of the Google market, at least the popular applications. And so we had the ability to decompile, we decompiled, we had all the source code. So what do? Well, I get on the virtual airplane and fly up to Silicon Valley. Those of you who know about Fortify, they provide the tools for doing professional static analysis. A lot of programs actually use these. I called up the VP of development or engineering, told him what we were doing, and he said, whatever you need. Basically, we've got tools, we've got engineers. We started with some of their static analysis stuff, but at the time, they were very web-oriented. They didn't really have much. That's very different now. In fact, they adopted a lot of the stuff we came up with after the fact. But most of this was actually, Will took the 52 different tests that we identified over that 6 months and encoded them using these static analysis tools on Fortify. It evaluated basically the state of the market at that time. And again, the tools are cool, but it's what we found that really was sort of groundbreaking. So we start with the stuff that we saw before. And this is the point. You got to remember, there was a lot of dissension. There was a lot of industry pushback saying, oh, no, that study was flawed. It's not that prevalent. So we said, okay, we got this one shot. We have the whole market. Let's show what it is. If we were wrong, we were wrong. If we were right, we were right. We were right. 33 applications, 246 applications access phone information. We actually found that 33 of them were taking that information and exfiltrating them off the phones. And actually, this is code. So this is the I'm going to show you decompiled code. This was stuff that we extracted from the market at the time. And so we were able to extract that information. We said, oh, okay, yeah, we saw this throughout a number of applications. And again, there was this moment where we said, okay, we really, really need some better controls on phone identifier information. Although that may be a losing battle because it still happens today. We saw more behavior. Now we start looking. We saw more tracking behavior. We saw that applications that were more and more apt to collect information and tie them to application specific requests. Things like get advertisement would tag on a phone identifier as just a parameter so that they could correlate gets from the same phone across different sessions. And if you think this is an application problem, it's not. Right? So what is a phone identifier in one application? Does that differ from a phone identifier in another application? No, it doesn't. Now you start tying different applications together as bundles and start being able to connect the behaviors in one application with the behaviors in another application. If you're a sports person and then this one and you're serving up apps in this cooking one, you can actually serve up some sport advertising in your cooking application. You start having cross application profiles being shown. And we saw this throughout. We started seeing in a much more direct way the connection between pseudo-identities and real identities. You can actually see logins being connected to device IDs and things like that. Now you actually have people, accounts, and applications. And these are not just sort of games. You're sort of thinking, well, this is all behavior from sketchy things and bad social networks. It's not. This is State Farm, right? This is actually an application from a legitimate business with a vertical application starting to connect your phone identifiers with your physical ID. Okay, is there a reason State Farm needs to know what your phone identifiers are? Well, if they do, they're not telling. That was a couple of interesting phone calls. Perhaps the most profound thing that we found in 2011 foreshadowed the way the software industry was going to evolve over the next half a decade. So what you see here is what's called probing for permissions. Okay, so this is something, and it's checking to see if it's got a permission. Why would an application check to see if it has permission? It defines the permissions an application's going to get, right? Why would it check to see if it had one?
Runtime changes?
No.
Libraries.
Libraries. So now what you start seeing in 2011 is applications are no longer simply being developed by a developer, but they're glue which puts together a whole bunch of libraries. So let me give you an example you guys run on your phone. Well, many of you do. Do you guys play any games on your phones? It's okay, your advisor isn't listening, okay? Okay? Yes, of course you do, right? So did that app developer of Flappy Birds or whatever crummy game that was, did they write the video, or did they write the game physics engine? No, of course not, right? So it turns out that when you get an application, you have an application developer, which is the signer, right? That's the thing that the market promises you. This is Bob's software house, right? And you know that's where the software came from. Perhaps that was true in 2009, but it isn't today. So you've got some part of that software that's from Bob's software house, maybe. But there's a lot of other software. There's libraries, game libraries. We see this a lot with financial transaction libraries. We see this a lot with ad networks. What you have is lots and lots and lots of different pieces of software being glommed together, and they constitute an application. And it's the aggregate behavior of all that software defines your security, but you have no way of knowing where those libraries came from. And in fact, you know, I have a PhD student who just finished where we spent basically the last 3 years trying to figure out how to identify libraries in APKs. Turns out it's a really hard problem. You know, the obvious thing would be to look at the namespace, right? So go look at the namespace and maybe you can find your libraries. Of course, then everybody starts obfuscating the namespace and now you're done, right? So you have to, and you end up having to do things like start generating code signatures and things like that. Remember I talked at the beginning about the distance in one hand between you and the developer is getting really small, but at the same time it's become more and more anonymous. This is sort of the logical endpoint of that. You now are downloading applications who are only nominally coming from the behavior. Now, why does that matter for security? Because basically what's going on here is you can have a library, and the application developer doesn't know all this, right? The application developer doesn't know what it's doing with permissions. So what the library does is it puts in its own malicious behavior, and it extracts the information, the permissions at runtime, and then uses them whenever they want. So that 50% number of ad networks. So 1 year later, of the 1,100 applications, 51% included some kind of ad network. And we saw some other things going on. For example, some applications actually had 2 or 3 or 4 or 5, in one case, 8 different ad libraries that it was putting into its application and spraying personal information across the internet. Now you have to remember that these ad networks, as they include them in applications, that's how the application monetizes your security. Okay? So not only were we right in 2010, but we were more right in 2011. Okay, and this has become what we refer to as a market norm. Last thing we looked at is, and this sort of foreshadows the second generation, were intent vulnerabilities. And I don't have enough time to go through all of this. I mean, this is kind of where my connection to Dave Wagner connects again. He had developed some parallel tools, not on the Java code on Dalvik, and he has something called Chondroid, where he was doing kind of a subset of the same analysis, essentially at the same time, only he's really focused on IPC or these intents. The short is that the IPC was not necessarily used for any overt malicious behavior, certainly at that time, but it was poorly protected. It was clear that the application developers really didn't know what the dangers were with opening up unprotected interfaces. They were subscribing to things they really shouldn't have been. And then there was just a lot of bad code. And to get to that point, really in 2011, a huge part of the market was very, very amateur code. And what was surprising was is the people who should know better, you know, companies that rhyme with like Gwitter, had really, really terrible code. You got that right. So there was a really there was a tremendous amount of what we call amateurish code. Now, an interesting question, and then this one actually was studied by one of my students, Patrick Trainer, a couple years later when he was at Georgia Tech. We didn't find malware. Now, that doesn't mean it wasn't there, but none of our tests that were looking sort of for sort of what we would refer to traditional virus kinds of malware, we just didn't really find it at that time. I have a couple theories about that, and we'll probably save that since I'm running out of time. The big theory is the following, is just that it wasn't clear at that time, and it's still not clear now how adversaries with traditional malware can monetize that compromise on phones just yet. It's not entirely clear, although that's changing fairly quickly. But we really just didn't see any sort of overt malware. And that puts us at the end of that first epoch of smartphone security. So basically, we land in the spring of 2012. We're about 3 years in. We've uncovered what people are doing with permissions. We've uncovered what the information flows, potentially dangerous information flows, were. And then we started looking at the software, started beginning to understand what were some of the pathological structures we saw that have security implications within this, in the code. And then this led us to the second generation, which I believe we're on sort of the tail end now, where much of the community and security has really taken some of this early work and said, okay, now we have good structures for evaluating code. Let's start building sort of tier one static analysis on top of these systems. In fact, you know, I sort of have a long history of doing these things. I sort of find myself wandering into the PL community more and more. If you're interested, there's a paper that myself and some folks from Germany wrote last year at IEEE Security and Privacy. It's SOK, Systemization of Knowledge, that talks about basically up until 2016, basically this whole body of work. It's not quite as historical. It was more focused on understanding the interplay between the research that's happening and the impact and structures of markets. But that second generation continues today. We are now building stronger and better analysis tools, so we're continuing to extract. And if you'll bear with me, I know I'm running out of time. I have a little bit of a philosophical bent. You know, one of the great things that Google did, so people always ask me the question, okay, what about Apple, right? You know, are they better or more secure? The answer is, who the hell knows? What Apple did is they made everything opaque. You don't know what's going on. Right, they hide all of the details, and that's a security with obscurity play, which historically has not done so well. Now, perhaps in the short term, it's been better for Apple. But for Google, Google is getting more and better secure every single day. One of the best things Google ever did is myself and many other people like me have spent the last decade making Android more secure, understanding the market, using the tools of our trade to inform public policy, but also to inform Google, hey, here are things that you can do. Here's why you want to restructure that permission system. Here's why perhaps adding some of the runtime revocable permissions is the right thing to do in certain kinds of contexts. And by the way, in fact, some of the startups that's come out of UCI are actually building better infrastructure for providing security within these runtime contexts within the Android system. And so in the long, Google is going to win the security game, because Apple's pretty smart, but they're not as smart as the rest of us all put together. And I think there's a model here, right? I think there's a model here that says open systems are good for security, okay? And I think that should be, you know, sort of if you want to walk away with some sort of meta statement from my talk today, is that I think the kinds of things that we learned in the genesis of this whole new area of mobile system security could be replicated in operating systems if we could just get our hands on Windows. Jeez, give me the code. Let me spend a decade making Windows better. Don't get me wrong, Microsoft is really, really smart. But the more they expose to me, the better they're going to be. And I think as the market demands more and more security, at least my hope that we're going to find ourselves more and more in that space. We're going to see more and more of the artifacts of these systems, and so that we can contribute to the security of them. Okay, this is my, if you want to write a thesis in the next 3 years on this topic, program analysis, it's cool again, PL is cool again. if you didn't know, particularly in a security context. Library identification and isolation is basically looking at how do you start parsing apart the multiple developer morass we have in Android systems, either from a structural standpoint, providing independent name, sandbox namespaces, or execution environments. I'm working some with the Federal Trade Commission on privacy disclosures. We need to say more. We need the industry to say more about what they're doing with our information. What are you getting? What are you doing with it? And how are you retaining it? And what can you do with it later? These are not hard questions, right? We understand how to ask these questions. We've been looking at it for at least 20 years. And then enforcing it, basically providing structures in our environment that say, okay, if you say you're not gonna exfiltrate these phone identifiers, can we provide enforcement for doing that? Another one is moving away from the tenant model. There's too many carriers and too many platform developers, in my opinion, that see that as their phone, which you are just borrowing. They can place all sorts of software on your system you can't remove, features you can't identify. In fact, there's some pretty serious Federal Trade Commission stuff going on right now with some of the stuff that's on some of these phones, some that is quasi-spyware. And then human factors, finally. Thanks, Marius. Human factors, how do we make user-centric security actually work, right? So you say yes, right, every time you download an application. Is that a meaningful statement of security? You know what that is? It's not yes, it's leave me alone. That's all you're really saying, is you don't really care. How can we change that dynamic? How can we somehow inform our cognitive models of what security should be and inform us and say, hey, here are the implications, right? If you knew a particular application was doing something you didn't want it to, wouldn't it be nice if the application at least exposed that in a way that you could understand? Now, of course, we're the cognoscenti, we're computer scientists, but what about your aunt, right? What about that dumb cousin, right? You gotta find something for him. I got plenty of dumb cousins, don't worry. So what does this all mean? Security. As of 2007, nature of life on this planet changed for people living in the technology advanced world. How we communicate, how we do our finances, how we find a mate, how we connect with our friends, how we do our jobs has changed in very fundamental ways. And that has rearranged our priorities. That has rearranged our relationship with our data and our computation. And therefore, we need to be able to adapt with it. We can continue to apply the same old rules of security and the same old security structures. It simply won't work. And that applies also with the social element of, and I mean social in the industrial sense, the social element of software. We have to recognize that software is being developed in ways that are brand new, and we don't know how to deal with it, right? We basically are getting lots of software that have no provenance. We have no way of knowing where it came from, and we need to be able to find ways to deal with that. And, you know, that's our job as a scientific community. We got to figure these things out. Not only science, you know, but also, you know, people in the software science, public policy space. And this isn't just about Android. It's about all of it, right? It's about all of these different infrastructures. So with that, I'd like to say thank you, and I appreciate your patience.
Thank you very much, Patrick. First of all, for the students here, the check-in word for today is security. That means you can go now if you really don't like this.
And I won't be offended.
We have some time for questions, like two or three. Any? Please, here.
Sure.
Thank you for the presentation. So most of my issues behaving you discussed has to do with finding PIIs on the phone and sending them over the network to some remote server. So and you detected that by using tools from program analysis. Since then, sending things over the network is so central, there are a bunch of approaches that monitor the network itself and see what the network is leaking.
Correct.
Do you have any comment about the value of that approach versus program analysis?
So the question really is, So there's a lot of basically what you would refer to as generalized detection at the network boundary. And really, you know, the taint droid is really a variant of that. That's dynamic analysis, which was looking at taints that were exiting the phone. But there's deeper analysis you want to do. You want to be able to understand the semantics of the information that's transiting that interface, and there are lots of techniques for doing that. Knowing what application it came from, and there are ways of actually tracking that within the operating system, you can actually do that. That's really important, and people are starting to work on that space. I think it's going to be an important component. We actually see that a lot, not just inside the phones, but we see that at the network provider level too. I think we were talking about something where they're at the network provider level. They were looking for the codec, the malicious behaviors. What was the
stage?
They were looking for like stage fright stuff, stage fright vulnerabilities. So we're seeing it both at the phone and certainly at the provider level.
Any more questions?
Sir,
so in one of your slides, you were talking about like sending these identifiers without user notification.
Right.
So I want to ask about that notification part. So let's say you want to let them know, how effective are they? First of all, how big is the bandwidth of the user? Will they be annoyed if you start bombarding them with all these notifications?
Yeah.
Will they even know what the notification means?
Right, so this is a really interesting question. This sort of connects to the human usability stuff. So there's actually a bunch of work that happened in 2000. It refers to something called the P3P, was sort of the original system. And there are platforms which basically allow you to say, here are things that I find objectionable. And then at runtime, the system can say, this application during installation, hey, you said you cared about phone number. This thing is downloading a phone number, and here's what it says it's doing that information. If you're privacy interested, you will, you know, if you specify what you care about up front and then you follow through, then yes. That's one model. And then there's another model, which is sort of the parental model, which says, here are, you know, you, my son is 14, he has a smartphone, and I say, here are the things that I don't want my son to share. That becomes an indelible policy inside the phone. And then any application which provides a policy that says it's sharing that kind of information that's outside the scope of my comfort zone, it basically says, dad says you can't, go talk to dad because he won't let you install that application. So there are different usage models here. But you're absolutely right. I mean, the history of privacy has been this problem. Is that you're just overwhelmed with information and you don't know what to do with it. And you might do it the first three times and then you just start saying, leave me alone, leave me alone, leave me alone. That's a human scale problem. And that's where you sort of turn to automatic enforcement.
Okay.
One question.
Sure.
So it seems like with the new sort of malicious behavior in Android, you have dynamically loaded code and you have highly obfuscated code, potentially encrypted code. Encrypted code that is dynamically loaded and then analyzed. What are your thoughts about sort of the limitations of program analysis to deal with these sorts of more complicated?
Right. So yeah. I mean, there are techniques at runtime that you can use to combat static analysis. Right. Encrypted code is a great example they use a lot. You know, that gets around signature-based stuff as well. So basically, a lot of the infrastructure now we see is the runtime environment detects when you're having code that has not been through a vetting process. For example, it's decompiled, talks to your notch code. In that case, you hope the runtime environment can detect that it's happening and then just prevent it from executing. Static analysis, by definition, just can't handle that case, unless it can reverse that process and recreate a runtime environment. But that's a much nastier proposition.
Okay, thank you very much again. All right.